How well did I do?
Well, if you're like most people who've done this experiment, this has been done a lot of times. In fact, it's based on a board game. People actually try to hum or they tap a particular song, and other people in the room try to guess what it was. And if you've done one of these games, it's really difficult. And in fact, people who guess, an audience of about 100 people who guess, find that about 2.5% of people guess correctly. So that's pretty bad. And you remember, we went and talked to Lee Ross at Stanford University. Now, he was the supervisor of this woman's project, who actually did this experiment formally, named Elizabeth Newton, in the 1980s. And she found exactly that. I think people guessed about 50% of people in the auditorium would guess correctly, right? When in fact, only about 2.5% of the people in the auditorium guessed correctly. So here's what Lee had to say about her project. You had a student in, I think, 1990, Elizabeth Newton, right, who did a tapping experiment. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I must say, the real author of that study was my brother, who was a musician.
Really?
And he used to do this when I was a kid.
Yeah.
And he showed me this interesting phenomena, that if you tap out a tune, you think you know for sure what it is. It seems really obvious to you. And in part, that's because when you're tapping the tune, you hear the music that accompanies it. And you know when you're not tapping whether that's a musical rest or a sustained note. This is something you only can appreciate by trying it. But I would urge anyone seeing the series to try it on someone. Tap some really familiar song, you know. You can tap the national anthem, or you can tap Jingle Bells or something really familiar. And to you, it'll seem absolutely inevitable that the other person will know, and they'll look at you with a kind of blank look. So when Elizabeth Newton came along, I had described this phenomenon to her, and she said, oh, that's great, let's make a study of it, and it became part of her dissertation.
Now, the idea is that when you're listening to these songs as an audience member, to the person who's tapping, and you know what it is that you're looking for, it's extremely vivid from the inside, right? Because you're kind of following along, you're listening to the music. But if you're not familiar with the music, it's just tapping. And so it's really difficult from somebody kind of standing in the shoes of an audience member to guess what it is that you're tapping. But for you, it seems so obvious, right? Like, how could you not guess green sleeves in this particular case? It's obvious, right? Right, but from the audience's perspective, it's not obvious, right? They're just hearing, you know, songs or tapping on their hand, and they can't interpret what it is that's being portrayed. Part of the reason, as Lee said in the interview, is that you can't tell whether, you know, a delayed note, whether it's sustained because it's a note that's carrying on, or whether, you know, you're holding it because it's a break in the music. You can only tell that from the inside, right? You can't tell it from objectively, from kind of the audience member's perspective. Now, this is going to be an example that we're going to return to again and again in the course, and the idea is that it's really difficult to put yourself in the shoes or see things from the perspective of other people. And that's going to be something we're going to work on again and again throughout the entire course. And I think this is a really nice example of that.
I've got a great example of this. It's a song by Regurgitator. I've been using this example for years. And what I get people to do is I just play the song from the start without saying anything. And I say, there's an electronic voice here, and it's actually saying English words. And I want you to tell me what the lyrics of this song are.
Still.
play it through, and people say, oh, I think I got this word, or I think he said salmon or people, or lots of things come through. And then I say, okay, let's play it again. And this time, as the song is playing, I show the lyrics on the screen as the song is playing. Is incredible. All of a sudden, people can hear vividly exactly what these words are and what the electronic voice is, like it was there all along. And people sometimes think that I'm playing a trick on them, that I played two tracks, but no. When you know what the lyrics are, the words just sound crystal clear.
There's another really good example of this, where people find hidden messages in songs. So you can either play a song forward or you can play it backward. And when you're listening to it, you can hear messages that may not have been there intentionally on behalf of the band. And so people have some pretty creative sort of interpretations of what the actual backward or forward messages say.
I spoke to John Vokey about exactly this. He was involved in a legal case, actually, with a band called Judas Priest, and he has an incredible story about his involvement in that case and what happened. You have to hear it. It's fantastic.